So let's get started with Hadoop version 1. So what is Hadoop? It's a framework for scalable processing of data. It's pretty much based on Google's MapReduce paper. It's widely used in the big data industry, and in fact there has been a complete ecosystem layered on top of the MapReduce idea and Hadoop file system. So it's also a very good example of a distributed system. And it will demonstrate a lot of aspects that we discussed last week about architectures and how to design distributed systems. Hadoop consists of two components that are tightly coupled. One is the Hadoop Distributed File System, or HDFS, and the second is MapReduce Execution Engine, which allows you to schedule programming tasks or computation on top of the HDFS files. So a question that you may have at this point is, why should we actually combine storage and execution paradigms into one engine? Why not have compute and storage separately? Well, there is one key benefit that you may obtain, that is that you can exploit data locality and basically avoid network transfer when you combine it. So the idea with Hadoop is that you ship the compute, so the algorithms and the programs, to the data, because the data is actually expected to be really big, right? This is in contrast to shipping the data to the compute, okay? Which, again, the data might be very large. So let's have a look at these two components individually, and then we talk a bit about the architecture. So let's talk about HDFS first. So the goal of HDFS was to create a reliable storage on commodity off-the-shelf hardware. So that means basically cheap servers that you can buy anywhere. You put them in big racks, you interface them, cheap hardware, right? Should be used. It is implemented in Java. It provides a single writer, multiple reader concurrency model. That means you can have only one process that writes to a particular single file, but you can have multiple readers to the same file at the same time. It is highly scalable, so you see here 200 petabytes of storage is quite big, and have it run on 4,500 servers as well. It has the typical features that you would expect from a distributed file system, like access control list, Unix permissions, a hierarchical namespace. But for a distributed system, we know we also have to provide high availability and fault tolerance. Here we have also automatic recovery from typical issues. Hardware issues. We have a replication of data, which is pipelined as we will learn. It has a level of rack awareness. That means it knows a bit how our servers are organized in our cluster, which is supportive for performance and high availability. And it has parallel file access, meaning that you can different nodes, different processes accessing this file system at the same time. So Hadoop comes with a file system. Various ways of accessing and interfacing the file system. One way is the Hadoop file system shell that you can, in the virtual machine, use with the command Hadoop space fs space, and then you put in a command, which is a typical Unix command, for example, ls. And then you can give even the name of the Hadoop file system that you want to query. Here we can prefix it with HDFS, but we can just typically omit this kind of prefix and just give a normal hierarchical file name, absolute or relative path. So the commands supported, like ls here, there are various. Some are for reading files, some are for writing files, some are for changing permissions, and these are the typical Unix commands that you will use. You find them here. There are some that are more interesting that I want to quickly mention. One is when you read files, there is a get merge command, where you may wonder at this point, why do we want to merge something? Well, as we will learn later, when you run a MapReduce job, it actually creates multiple files in one directory, and this get merge command allows you to create one, basically, output in this case, which is the final output that you may need from a MapReduce job. Okay, so this is really a useful command. So you can put files from a local file system to a remote Hadoop file system, which allows you to upload basically data to this file system and download the result using, for example, getMerge. There are some special commands that are quite interesting. For example, distcp is a MapReduce parallelized data copy, which allows you to copy large files between clusters quicker. You can check some data, you can clear trash, which is not usual in a Linux file system, and you can change the replication factor of an individual file or directory. So let's now dive into the architecture. And as we'll see in the exercise, you will do a little bit of your own research trying to understand what's going on. Don't worry if you don't get all the details. It's quite sophisticated, I would say. But let's get started. So what kind of components do we have? We have a name node, which is a central manager for the file system namespace. Basically, it gives you the file names and the permissions, the metadata that you have of the files. Also, it tells you about the file, where you find the blocks of the file. So we'll see about that. There is basically only one name node, but for high availability and fault tolerance, we provide a secondary name node, which has basically the same information as the primary name node. Then we have data nodes. There can be many, arbitrary many of these data nodes that provide the storage for objects, and they communicate among each other to enable this replication feature, as we will see. Then we have a task tracker component, which allows you to run these MapReduce jobs with the individual stages. And the task tracker basically job, what it does, it provides you a number of slots, they are called slots, for tasks. So a task runs, for example, on one slot. And what is a slot? A slot is basically mapped to the available logical CPUs. So if you buy a microprocessor and it has four CPUs, cores, for example, then you have four slots. Okay, so it makes sense if you run a parallel task to run a task in one slot and then another one in another one until all the slots are used up. So typically a task is tried to be scheduled on a slot on the machine, on the data node that has the data. So, but if all slots are occupied, as you will see, the task will try to run on the same rack, which was this rack awareness that we talked about. Then we have the job tracker, that is a singular component again, like the name node. It exists only once in our cluster, and it's the central manager for running MapReduce jobs. So for high availability, we have again a secondary job tracker. Also, Hadoop comes with a couple of tools for accessing and managing the file system, like rebalancing of data and so forth. But we don't go too much into those details. But you know already one command, which was Hadoop FS. So I would consider this to be part of the tools. So let's have a different perspective on the Hadoop server roles. So we have clients. Clients try to access the distributed data storage or to run MapReduce jobs. So we have master servers that will accept requests to store data, manage data, or to run an application. And we have this name node and we have this job tracker. Both have secondary instances for high availability, as I said. And then we have basically, as it's called here, slaves. So these are the masters. They control all the slaves in this case that can run on arbitrary number of nodes. As I said, an example would be 4,500 nodes. And in each of them runs a data node or a task tracker process. So this was a very logical view. Now let's have a look of the system level perspective of the hardware. So like I said, we buy servers and these servers get stacked into a rack. Okay, a rack typically is equipped for this cost efficiency reasons with an internal switch that connects together all those different servers that you find in the rack. These switches then are interconnected to top level switches here that somehow connect with the internet, potentially, or wider, bigger cluster systems, which then connects to the user. Okay, so the racks, the servers in the racks communicate over this top, these switches inside the rack to the top level switch. Therewith, each rack can communicate with each other. So now we have to run, and on such a system, we have to run and distribute our processes, our server roles that we talked about. So what we can do, we take rack one, we place in this rack a name node. And then we have our data nodes and task trackers running each on one server. Therewith, all the servers have means to run a job or to store data. Then on another rack, we run the job tracker, for example, and then on another rack, we run the secondary name node or the secondary job tracker. Well, it doesn't make sense to run the secondary name node or job tracker on the same rack as, for example, the same name node is placed. Okay, because if you run both on the same rack and this switch dies, has a hardware problem, then your whole cluster becomes not responsive anymore and you can't access the storage or you can't run jobs anymore if it is the job tracker. Therefore, you store it on different switches for these reasons. Also, then we may run clients if we like on any rack. So it could be a rack where there are data nodes and task trackers, but it could be also a rack that has no data node or task tracker at all. So there could be dedicated racks just for the clients, okay? But in this case, we have a client placed on a server running on a rack where there are also data nodes and task trackers. Good, so this is how you would lay out the server roles onto existing hardware. Now let's do the little bit of excursion such that we can understand later what's going on in the background and the architecture. So an important topic is how do we map data structures to files that are placed in our file system and more specifically to streams in general. So what you need to do, you have your main memory. In your main memory, you have a data structure. That could be a table, but it could be also a tree, for instance, right? Which is uses pointers from C and C++. So it's a difficult to lay out somehow in memory. Somehow we have to create a byte stream that can be stored in our files, because a file is just an array of bytes, pretty much. And from this byte stream that we have created, which we store in a file, we later, when we read the data, we need to create somehow a data structure again, which was our table or our tree in main memory. Right, so what is now serialization? Serialization is the process of creating a byte stream from our data structure. So data structure goes to byte stream, that is the serialization process. And the deserialization process is when we take the byte stream and create our data structure again in memory. And of course, with such byte streams, well, like I said, you can store them in a file, but you can also transfer them over the network, for instance, which is quite useful in many cases. So as it is tedious to do this task from a programmer's perspective, right, how do I serialize, for example, floating point data? How do I serialize a table, a tree, and so on? For this reason, there exist serialization frameworks. And these frameworks, they provide code and typically tools that ease this process, and they provide, for instance, code to serialize basic types like floating point, integers, and so forth, arrays of floats, and so on. But also they support you to write data type specific serializers, like I mentioned, for a tree data type, the tree data structure. There are various frameworks here, I list for different programming language, a couple of them. We will have a look a little bit at the Java ones, because they are relevant in terms of Hadoop. So what is different in terms of serialization framework, in contrast to doing it manually, is that a serialization framework must provide platform independence. So you create a stream on, for example, a Linux machine, you store it in a file, you possibly want to read it back on a Windows machine or with a different software. Also, performance plays an important role in this serialization frameworks, so it's good to use those frameworks and not trying to code this functionality again. Good, let's talk a little bit about how we map now our byte stream to storage. So what Hadoop does in the first place is that files are in fact split into blocks. Okay, for example, a block size is 64 megabyte. And these blocks are then distributed across our nodes, which are basically our data servers, right? Like we mentioned here, we had our data nodes, so the servers that provide this data node functionality, and they store blocks of files, okay? And blocks can be compressed, which increases the efficiency and saves capacity a little bit. And Hadoop provides now various potential record readers for the different file formats. Okay, so ad hoc, you can store a lot of different file types, and it's possible to read them into Hadoop using those serialization frameworks. So from byte stream to a data structure that can be directly processed using a MapReduce job. So text files are very simple, so I can print them here, typically with the Linux file ending, but they can also use different ones. They are splittable, what we learned what this means later. Add new lines means this is a record, and the next, each line is basically a record that may make sense, okay? Then we have separated value files, which are CSV files, well, typically separated by comma. There is a key limitation in Hadoop that there is no header supported for reason that we'll see later. They do not support block compression, but they have other benefits. Now there are some internal file formats that are quite useful and used to store intermediate data products. So sequence files are binary files that store key value pairs. And it's quite efficient to store key and value inside this file. You can compress those files, and they are widely used as internal data structure. And the records are split in HDFS by using some synchronization marker, what we'll see a bit later. Then there are map files, which extend the sequence files, which provide also an index for the keys. So when you look in a normal file like this, and you would ask the question, well, I'm looking for the line that contains, for example, John as a name, right? This could be our key. What values does John have? Well, I would have to read the whole file and find the line where the name is John, pretty much. The first column is John. So to make this more efficient, the map file has an index such that you can quickly find out which lines contain the respective key. So this is a bit more efficient. It's also an internal file format. Then there's the ARFO file format. It's now, over the last couple of years, I'd say more dominant in the Hadoop environment and used widely. It has the benefit that it's self-describing data format. That means you can store the schema a little bit inside this data file, so you know that this is, for example, the first column is a string, the second one is a float. And you can even give it a kind of a semantical meaning, saying, you know, this is the name, this is, I don't know, the income, and this is the age or whatever. Okay, it's widely used, and it allows you to exchange the files between different tools in this Hadoop ecosystem. Okay, so I can write it, for example, in Hadoop, and then I can read it with another tool like Spark or what have you. So now that we have understood that there are different files and they are stored in blocks, the question is, how do we actually write in HDFS data? So we have a client, of course. A client has to trigger somehow reading and writing of files. So in this case, the client wants to write three blocks, for example, because he wants to write 180 megabyte of data. Each block has up to 64 megabyte of data, so we need three blocks of data. So the client first needs to contact the name node. I need three blocks to write three blocks, and then the name node says, well, here you go. You can write this data to data node 1, 5, and 6. And then the client directly communicates with data node 1, writing the first block, to data node 5, writing the second block, and data node, the last data node, to write the next block. These data nodes then, they will replicate the block, as we will see, independently. But that is the task of the client. Okay, this is the perspective and the operations that happen between, and the interaction that happens between clients and the servers. So what happens under the hood now is, for one block, so when the client asks the name node to give you the information about which data nodes to store, the name node in fact checks first this rack-aware schema, so it knows, okay, in one rack I have data node 1, in another rack I have data node 5 and 6. What it shouldn't do, it shouldn't place all the replicas in the same rack, because if the rack switch goes down, well, there is no communication, no possible anymore to read and write to this particular block of data, which is a problem in our distributed system. So now it consulted this, so it made the name node made the decision to store on 1, 5, and 6 servers. Now the client transmits one block. If we just look at one block, it first communicates with the data node 1, because the server name node server said, well, store the first block on node 1. So the client tells data node 1, I want to store 64 megabyte of data. Data node 1 figures out as well, based on the request, it needs to store the data and replicate the data on data node 5 and 6. So the data node 1 communicates to data node 5, I need to store this data block. And data node 5 communicates with data node 6, I need to store this data block as well. And then basically the data node 6 replies to data node 5, that's great, please store the data. So it acknowledges. Data node 5 acknowledges to data node 1, I'm ready, and so is data node 6 pretty much. And data node 1 acknowledges to the client, I'm ready as well. So at this point, the client knows that this pipeline is ready and it dumps the data to data node 1, which then starts to, immediately after the data is sent, to send the data to data node 5 and replicate this data. So this provides data protection, but at the same time, from the client, you need to transfer the data only once. Okay? But here in this example, our data is replicated 3 times for redundancy reasons. So, if you draw this figure for multiple blocks, you would see that, as we said, each block is replicated 3 times. You basically get 3 times the storage capacity occupied, and 3 times the network traffic than normally. But from the client, you would just have to transfer it 1 time. So here is an example for 1 terabyte file. Well, you need 3 terabyte of storage and 3 terabyte of network traffic. And you can see that when the client here starts to write the one block to data node 1, it then uses the data node 1 communicates over a switch, in this case this root level switch, with another data node to replicate the data. And there is some replication happening inside the rack, because we picked 2 nodes, data nodes from one rack all the time. So that means it's local, which is typically faster. And also while this takes place, block B and block C gets replicated. And only once the data is completely written to all our replicas, in our example here, okay, if you just look at one block, it's written and to all the nodes, then our operation is completed. So now let's have a look at how we read from HDFS. Well, the client wants to read a file like results.txt file. It has to contact the name node. The name node figures out on the metadata, well, what is my file consisting of? In this case, it's consisting of 3 blocks, block A, B, and C. And it knows block A is replicated about on data node 1, data node 5, and 6. So it gives this answer pretty much to the client, and the client will typically contact the first data node on each instance for each block. But if the server is down, it will go on and contact the next server. So this again provides high availability, and if a node is broken, you can still access the data files. And you can see here how the data is placed, how these blocks are placed across the different nodes, and you can see that, you know, the client reads block A from this node, block C from this node, and block B from this node. Okay. So in terms of high availability, there is often a problem that the absence of communication doesn't necessarily mean everything is okay. For that reason, what you need to do is you need to kind of continuously communicate. And if there is a continuous communication and then it is absent, then you know something is broken. This is an heartbeat mechanism, which is widely common in distributed systems. So it works like that the data nodes communicate with the name node and periodically, in typically about every 3 seconds, sends a heartbeat, which means it tells the server, the name node, I'm alive. And the server then knows, okay, at least I can communicate with data node, with this data node, there is no problem. So also what they do, they every 10th heartbeat, for instance, they send a block report, which means, well, a data node says, I have blocks A and C, which then the name node can use to update the metadata and identify if there was a problem, potentially triggering a re-replication of data. Note that if the name node is down, and the secondary name node, of course, then you can't access HDFS at all. So now, what happens if one of these heartbeats is missing? Typically, the system retries, but if there are a couple of heartbeats, a sequence of heartbeats missing, then you may know that the node is not accessible anymore, in this case node 3, may not communicate for a couple of heartbeats. Then the name node needs to figure out what, from the metadata, which kind of data blocks are problematic. Well, it knows here in data node 3 I have stored block A and C. Well, it also knows in which rack this data node is stuck. And now it has to replicate those two blocks potentially depending on the replication factor. So it has to re-replicate the data to make sure that the data is safe. Because even if you have, for instance, like three replicas, then what happens, one node goes down, maybe you have a problem with your storage, you can't recover the data at all, so it's lost forever. Then you have another one that is broken, but then you have no redundancy anymore and the data would be lost forever. To prevent that, you have to really re-replicate data. So that concludes our initial understanding of Hadoop. And like I said, in the exercises, you will have the chance to revisit these architectural decisions that are made here and critically reflect why these decisions are made. I think I said pretty much everything, but it's still a good idea to look through all the aspects that we discussed last week and find out how they are resolved.